We are so glad to be with you again for this program of Hope Today, a time of spiritual encouragement and joy. Thank you for joining us. In today's program, we will be discovering Jesus at prayer. Did you know that you can talk to God at any time and for any reason? God hears, listens, and will respond. It is a two-way communication essential for the relationship God wants to have with you and I. You may want to open your Bible to today's passage in John chapter 17 and verses 1 to 8. Remember the daily study guide and additional teaching at LIGHT, the letter N, the word life.ca. More from Pastor Tom Cullen in the few moments ahead. Mac Wigfield will come now to bring us to inspirational gospel music. Thank you, Mac.
Good to see you, so to speak, and welcome to Gospel Music on Hope Today. I'm going to be talking about Jesus' prayer life to some extent today. Good to know as we begin the program, isn't it? Jesus prays for me. Here are the Craguns.
Another day, another man, another life that ends hanging on a cross. But today was not the same as this man hung there bleeding from the nails that I'd put through him. He prayed for my forgiveness. Jesus prayed for me. After all I had done, he still prayed for me. Surely he's the Son of God. My life's forever changed. I will never be the same since Jesus pray for me.
Oh, what a thought that the God of all that is prays for me. When I'm lost, when I don't know what I need, he intercedes.
Do you remember the time when Jesus' disciples came to him and said, "Lord, teach us to pray"? Not a bad request, is it? Gold Harbour singing for us, "Lord, teach me how to pray."
Lord, teach me how to pray, that I might see. Lord, teach me what to say and say me free, that I may ever go at your command. Lord, teach me how to walk and hold. Down on my knees, that I may know that you have heard my plea. Lord, teach me how to use my life for thee. Lord, teach me how to help the
life's a journey day by day, filled with laughter and with pain. But I know that He is with me through it all. When with clouds my path is dim, storms and doubt arise within, I find refuge in the shadow of the cross. I am calmly resting in the Lord. I am trusting fully in His word. Oh, whatever life may bring, my resolve will always be, I am calmly resting in the Lord. Shall I yield to idle fear, giving way to every tear, when the Lord Himself has brought me to this hour? Peace be still, my weary soul. Find your strength in Christ alone. For the Savior holds me by His mighty hand. I am calmly resting in the Lord. I am trusting fully in His word. May bring, my resolve will always be, I am calmly resting in the Lord. And when all my strength shall fail, and I lie within the grave, I won't fear, for He has given me this promise.
will roll my stone away. I am calmly resting in the Lord. I am trusting fully in His word. Oh, whatever life may bring, my resolve will always be, I am calmly resting in the Lord. I am calmly resting in the Lord.
You're listening to Hope Today, and we've been on a journey these last months, discovering Jesus through the New Testament book of John. Today, we are given the privilege of overhearing Jesus at prayer in chapter 17 and are given a wonderful picture of our Lord's nature and His character. It is our desire that you will deepen your belief that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in His name. Here's Don Macaulay with Morning by Morning.
When the sun sets on all that has been, you are my comfort as night closes in. We hope for the dawn with your mercies new, 'cause all that is never changing you.
Your great faithfulness, they
In the New Testament book of John, chapter 17, we see Jesus at prayer. And he begins his prayer with the words, "Father, the hour has come." Those words refer to the cross. It refers to the time, the appointed time for Jesus' death, when the perfect sacrifice would be offered for the sin of the world. Do you know that for thousands of years, creation and humankind have been waiting with bated breath for the time when God's promised one would come and set right all that had gone wrong through humanity's rebellion? Way back at the beginning of time, we witnessed God in the book of Genesis promise Adam and Eve that from them would come one who would crush the head of the serpent. And God gave a promise, the first promise of a Messiah in Scripture, right after the sin of Adam and Eve. And Eve gives birth to a son, and she names him Cain. And she presents him to the world with a heart full of gratitude, saying, "I have produced a man with the help of the Lord." She presents him to the world with a great flourish. The thrust of the Hebrew there is that, "I have brought forth the man." She is saying, "This is the man you promised, God. Ta-da!" But as time passed, it became evident that she had not given birth to the Messiah, but to a murderer. And ever since that time, humanity and creation has waited for God's promised one to deliver humanity from its bondage to sin. And the time has finally arrived when the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent by dying as our substitute and redeemer on the cross. Up to this time, the hour had not come. But now with the coming of Jesus, it has arrived. The Savior of the world would give his life for you and for me. The Masters Four sing, "It's Still the Cross."
It's not conservative or liberal, however they're defined. It's not unbound interpretation or the judgment of the mind. It's the opposite of politics, power or prestige. It's about a simple message and whether we believe.
It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin and sets the captive free. Jesus, that has power to save the lost. It's still the cross.
Now we can water down theology, preach a word to soothe our needs. We can justify sweet subtle lies that are wrapped in noble deeds. We can alter our convictions to adapt to social whims. But we cannot change the gospel or the truth contained within.
It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin and sets the captive free. It's still the name of Jesus that has power to save the lost. It's still the cross. Oh, some may say it's banned religion or ancient history. The cross of Jesus still remains the price for sin that sets us free.
It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin
and sets the captive free.
It's still the name.
That has power to save the lost.
still the cross.
In John chapter 17, we witness Jesus at prayer about his impending death on the cross and his resurrection. And in that prayer, he says, God, may I be glorified so that you may be glorified. I know that sounds a bit strange, but if you think of it, it isn't. If a hockey team wins the Stanley Cup, the team is glorified, but so is the coach. If a race car driver wins a race, he's praised, but so is the pit crew. That's what Jesus is saying. Let the cross and the resurrection be brought to its triumphant completion. May I be glorified so that you may be glorified, God. That word glory in this context speaks of the splendor of God, the magnificence, the brilliance, the majesty of God. So Jesus is asking that in the cross, that the splendor of God would be revealed, that God's majestic character would be seen. Do you see it? Do you see the splendor of God in the cross? Do you see the splendor of his love for you? That he would send his son to die on the cross for you? Do you see the splendor of his justice, that he demands that sin be paid for and pays the price himself? Do you see the splendor of his strength, that he would allow his son to die on the cross and not send 10,000 angels to rescue his son while he hung there dying? Do you see the glory, the splendor of God in the cross? It's there for those who have eyes to see. Krista Noble sings the truth in Jesus Messiah.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so
all the glory.
Francis Rowley was a Baptist minister for the First Baptist Church of North Adams, Massachusetts in 1886. He remembers, and I quote, "The church and community were experiencing a period of unusual interest in religious matters, and I was assisted by a remarkable young Swiss musician by the name of Peter Billhorn," end of quote. One Sunday following the evening service, Peter Billhorn asked Pastor Rowley to write the words of a hymn that he could then set to music. During that night, the words of our hymn for today came to Francis. Peter Billhorn composed the music, and Ira Sankey published the hymn in 1887. Peter Billhorn composed over 2,000 gospel songs. Not only a skillful songwriter, he was also known to be an earnest soul winner. Realizing that there was a need for a portable music instrument for use in street ministry, he designed a folding organ weighing only 16 pounds and started its manufacturing process, a venture that became most successful. Prior to 1908, Peter preceded Homer Roadheaver as the song leader for the well-known street evangelist Billy Sunday. The theme of "I Will Sing the Wondrous Story" is found in Psalm 89, verse 1, where the psalmist states, "I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever." Listen now to George Beverly Shea with his rendition of "I Will Sing the Wondrous Story."
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How he left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. I was lost, but Jesus found me, found the sheep that had gone astray. Through his loving arms around me, drew me back into his way. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea.
How would you define eternal life? Jesus says in John chapter 17 that eternal life is knowing the only true God and Jesus Christ. This means that eternal life refers not only to a quantity, but also to a quality of life. Eternal life is a quality that we can possess right now through faith in Jesus Christ. It is knowing the only true God and Jesus Christ. And of course, to know God, Jesus means so much more than simply having a head knowledge of God. It's to have a relationship with Him that is close and intimate. Knowing God is listening to His Word and receiving it as the Holy Spirit brings it to our hearts. It's recognizing God's character as it is revealed in His Word. It's following Him in obedience and recognizing His divine love for you and rejoicing in it. There's a great story of a grandmother who was visiting her 8-year-old granddaughter. The granddaughter said, "Grandma, do you know me in a second?" "Yes," said the grandmother. "Do you know me in a minute? Do you know me in an hour? Do you know me in a day?" Finally, the grandmother said, "I know you, little one. I've known you for a day, a week, a month, a year. I've known you even before you were born. I knew you when you were born. I know you that well." And the granddaughter said, "Knock, knock." And the grandmother said, "Who's there?" And the granddaughter said, "I thought you said you knew me." A believer would never fall for that knock-knock joke if God were to tell it. We would be able to say, "Lord, it is you. Come in." To know God is to be in relationship with Him. Here's Chris Renzema with Springtime.
You're the resurrection that we've waited for. You buried the night and came with the morning. You're the King of heaven. The praise is yours. The longer the quiet, the louder the chorus. So song, let hallelujahs flow like a river. We're coming back to life, reaching toward the light. Your love is like springtime. You're the living water, God, we thirst for you. The dry and the flower and bloom. You're the sun that's shining. You restore my soul. The deeper you call us, oh, the deeper we'll go. We will sing a new song. Come tend the soil of my soul. And like a garden, and like a garden I will grow. I will grow. Come tend the soil. Come tend the soil of my soul. Like a garden, and like a garden, I will grow. I will grow. I will grow. I will grow. We'll sing a new song. Stay.
In the New Testament book of John, we're able to eavesdrop on Jesus as he prays to God just before he goes to the cross. And in that prayer, he says to God his Father, "I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work that you gave me to do." From the cradle to the time Jesus ascended into heaven, he glorified the Father. He finished the work that God called him to do. True, a crucial part of it lay ahead of him, but Jesus puts it all in the past tense. As one commentator has said, there would be no wavering, no turning back, no failure. He was wholly committed to the work of the cross, as he and his Father both knew. The agony of the garden would not shake his resolve. The indignities and injustices of the trial, the horror of the cross, the silence of the grave were stepping stones on the predetermined way. The Lord would carry the divine purpose out to fulfillment. His obedience would stand the test, and he would be able to say as he breathed his last, "It is finished." Do you know the good news of that? Do you know that there's nothing more for you to add to your salvation? It is finished. Jesus Christ has completed the work that God the Father gave him to do. There's nothing left for you to do. Only believe. This is the good news. There's nothing for you to do for you to gain that quality of life that I've been speaking about. The work is done by Jesus Christ. He has acted in the obedience that you and I could not. Jesus has fulfilled the demands and has done the work for you and for me. So all God's promises are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. Housefires sing.
Father, kindness you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy.
Thanks so much for listening to Hope Today. Immanuel Worship sings the good news of God's Word in No Condemnation.
From the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Jesus Christ.
In John chapter 17, we witness Jesus in prayer, and as you read it, you discover that he says some pretty amazing things about his disciples. He says that they obeyed God's word, and they accepted his words, and knew with certainty that Jesus came from God. Does he know that one of them will deny him three times? Does he know that all the rest will leave him and run away in fear in his hour of need? All of them were weak in their faith and testimony. And this is what he says of them? Truly, we are given a glimpse of our Lord's nature. It is one of abundant grace. You know, sometimes we look at our faith and our service to God and we belittle it. We think we don't have a strong faith. We don't do great things for God. Our offering to God isn't much. But our Lord, in his grace, receives even the smallest act of service. A cup of water offered in his name is received by him. He's that gracious toward us. And the same with your faith. Don't belittle the faith you have in him. It may seem small and weak, but if it comes from the heart, it means the world to him. Don't think that you need to reach a level of faith before you commit yourself to him. He will take that small faith, and in grace, he will pour out his life into you. He's that gracious. Here's North Point Worship and Seth Condrey with Death Was Arrested.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin,
lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over.
Thank you so much, Pastor Tom. What a blessing this program has been. Discovering Jesus is knowing that his example of a relationship with his Father is also the relationship God wants with you and I too. Isn't that amazing and so reassuring? Please go to lightsandlife.ca where you will find the study guide for our next program and additional teaching you can watch. That is L-I-G-H-T, the letter N, the word life.ca. Before we are together next, you will find it helpful to read John chapter 18, verses 28 to 40, where we will discover Jesus on trial. You may want to hear this program or a previous one again, or you may want to share a program with a friend. You can do all that by visiting www.lightandlife.ca. Through the website, you can also send Pastor Tom and our team a note. We would love to hear from you. Hope Today is produced at Straight Path Studio. We look forward to being with you and your friends next time for another program of hope. Until then, keep looking ahead. Jesus is coming again.